I'm Norbert Gleicher, MD. I'm the medical director and chief scientist here at the Center for Human Reproduction in New York. And it's a pleasure being with you again. And this is the third in a series of three talks about the subject that we have gotten a lot of questions on over the last few weeks and months, and that is chemical pregnancies. And today, I want to address treatment, or should I say really prevention of chemical pregnancies. Because treatments really kind of do not exist because there's not enough time to treat a chemical pregnancy. By definition, a chemical pregnancy is very short-lived and therefore there's little for us to do. That shouldn't surprise. Even with threatened miscarriages at much more advanced pregnancy stages, real clinical pregnancies, frankly, we do not have many treatments because once a miscarriage starts, it is very difficult to stop the process. So we really have no treatment per se for early implantation that don't go on. But these chemical pregnancies still, at least in our opinion here at CHR, do have a meaning, and that meaning is that they must have an underlying cause. So what I mean by that? Miscarriages in general are frequent. The data show that about 15% on average of all pregnancies get miscarried, earlier, later, at all stages. And the number is obviously much lower than that average in younger years and can go as high as 50% if a woman gets pregnant in her late 40s. So miscarriages are age dependent. And to a degree that also applies to chemical pregnancies. And whenever we see something being age dependent, like miscarriages, we need to think what the potential causes can be. And when it comes to miscarriages, the overwhelming cause, not the only, but the overwhelming cause, are chromosomal abnormalities. As the eggs in a woman's ovary age in parallel with that woman aging, so do the chromosomal abnormalities in those eggs. And with it, unfortunately, the number of chromosomal abnormalities in embryos, and as a consequence of that, increasing miscarriages at every stage, including at very early stages in so-called chemical pregnancies. Now, nobody wants to try to prevent miscarriages of abnormal pregnancies, and that obviously also applies to those early chemical pregnancies or miscarriages, whatever you want to call them. But one needs to be cognizant of the fact that their occurrence relates with age. And so if you have a chemical pregnancy and or early, very, very early miscarriage at a very young age, if you have one, it's no deal. It is within the statistical probability of this happening. But in our opinion, it becomes a big mistake just because we don't count chemical pregnancies as real pregnancies to ignore if a young woman has two or three of those in a row. There's a very different statistical meaning to having two or three early chemical pregnancies in a row than just having one at random, which can really be bad luck. Once you get to two, and certainly once you get to three, then you really need to look for a deeper meaning. There may be something else going on here than just chromosomal abnormalities. picture's obviously different if you're dealing with a 45-year-old woman. Their chromosomal abnormalities are expected. So the possibility that even two or three chemical pregnancies may be due to chromosomal abnormalities is much higher. The point we're trying to make here is that while chemical pregnancies are not counted or shouldn't be counted, and we agree with that, we at CHR do not agree with ignoring chemical pregnancies. Chemical pregnancies send messages. They send messages within the context of who the patient is. And just as repeat miscarriages, once they become clinically visible on ultrasound, have great importance clinically, so do repeated chemical pregnancies or very early miscarriages. In other words, if even a young woman suddenly has a whole series of very early miscarriages, chemical pregnancies, think about other possibilities. And if it's not chromosomal abnormalities that lead to repeated pregnancy loss, then it is usually, not always, there are other possibilities too, but it is usually the maternal immune system. And that's very important, because there we can intervene. If it's chromosomal abnormalities that lead to the termination of a pregnancy, we don't want to intervene. But if it is the immune system that is causing these pregnancies to be lost, we have at least some potential treatments with which we can prevent those repeated losses from happening. So everything must be viewed in an individualized way within the context of who a given patient is. That's one of the things we pride ourselves here on, here at CHR. And I think it's one of the things that differentiates our center from so many other IVF centers. I hope I have told you told you some information that will be useful for you in the future. It was a pleasure visiting with you. Thank you very much.